Spread the word, oh man. Spread the word of Islam.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, most merciful, I greet you all, my dear viewers, in our Islamic way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, mercy, and blessings be with you all. In the coming few episodes, we shall be moving towards the end of this program on scientific precision in the glorious Quran. And we have already discussed the very many facets or aspects of precision in the glorious Quran to testify for the divine nature of this noble book. And we have concentrated on the scientific precision because we are living in an era of scientific and technological advancements never paralleled before in human history. And because of this, people have become highly fascinated with the results of science and technology and would ask always for the scientific proof for any argument you raise with them. And because of this, we have concentrated this program in 60 different episodes on the scientific precision in the glorious Quran. And we have not done justice to this aspect, but we gave you a taste of that great scientific precision in this noble book. We also discussed rules and regulations of dealing with this particular aspect, scientific precision in the glorious Quran, because this is a new area. Of course, it was discussed before, but with the great expansion in the scientific knowledge of today, it looks brand new topic, and of course it needs certain rules and regulations to deal with. Anybody indulging into that area without a great care, without adhering himself or herself to the rules and regulation of dealing with it, he can easily go astray and do more than good. And that's why we had elaborated about the rules and regulations of dealing with this very delicate area, the scientific precision in the glorious Quran. We also gave enough reasoning to indulge into that area because of the great scientific development of the time. After that, we discussed some of these aspects, such as the firmament and the earth in the glorious Quran. We discussed the creation of the universe, its destruction and its recreation. We discussed the earth in the glorious Quran. We discussed wind, clouds, earthquakes, water, seas and oceans. We discussed notions to some plants and their products, notions to some animals and their products. And in these few episodes that are left for us, we'll talk about Quranic notions to man, how the Quran refers to man, this highly honored creation of Allah, all glory be to him. And of course, the whole address of the Quran is to man. So we cannot cover that topic in a few episodes. But I have chosen for you a limited number of these topics. And let's start by verse number 21 in Surah Al-Dhariyat, chapter 51 in the glorious Quran, which reads, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, wa fi anfusikum afala tubsirun. And also in your own selves, will you not then see? And the Quran always directs the attention of man to look into the wonders of creation of Allah. And all these cosmic verses in the Quran, which exceed 1,200 explicit verses, in addition to a large number of implicit ones, these verses only speak about the wonderful creation, which can testify to the greatness of the Creator, to His oneness, to His supremacy above all His creation, to the necessity of the world to come, paradise and hell, and all the other unseen facts which cannot be observed by the human senses, so that the scientific precision by which these verses are recorded in the Quran can testify for the truth of the unseen facts mentioned in it, the truth of the prophethood of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and the supremacy of the Quran, which is the only form of divine guidance within the hands of man today that has been kept intact in exactly the same language of revelation, the Arabic language, preserved by the will of Allah, word to word and letter to letter. When all the previous forms of guidance to man, although we believe in its origins, yet they have all have either been completely lost or have suffered a great deal of human infiltrations and alterations that have distorted it very much and have infilled it with the human mistakes. When we read, وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ, Allah, all glory be to him, is directing our attention to the wonderful build-up of our own bodies. And we go around without thinking about that in any great detail. Enough to mention that the human body contains on the average 1,000 trillion cells, 1,000 million cells, living cells, on the average. It can be greater than that or slightly lesser than that. Each of these living cells, which is only 0.03 millimeter in diameter, Allah has given it the capabilities to produce more than 80,000 different types of proteins. And these proteins are the elementary blocks by which the living cell and the whole body actually is constructed. This large number of protein molecules actually cannot be produced by man in such a small size like the living cell. And of course, the efficiency by which the living cell far exceeds any establishment man has built, any factory he has constructed, or even any factory he has thought of without being able to bring it to reality. The greatest part of the living cell is the genetic code. And the genetic code is condensed in a tiny, small area within the nucleus of the living cell. This genetic code occupies an area that do not exceed 1/1,000,000 cubic millimeter. It contains 46 chromosomes, and each chromosome is composed of a large number of protein molecules, DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid, and these chromosomes are in the form of double helix DNA. It's revolving around an imaginary axis, and it is known as the double helix DNA strands or templates. The thickness of the wall of the DNA is in the order of 1/50,000,000 millimeter, and its diameter is in the order of 1/500,000 millimeter. Its length is about 2 meters when it is unfolded, and it contains more than 4 million chemical bases. And if we imagine the genetic code of the human being contains 18.6 billion chemical bases. If a single atom would go loose from any of these chemical bases, this creature can either be highly distorted or can never exist. Also, we see that each chromosome is divided by certain markers into a number of genes that range in number between 20 and 25,000. And each of these genes actually controls the production of a certain amount of proteins. And It is amazing that the number of chromosomes in any living species is a limiting number for this particular species, which proves to every sane mind that creation cannot be the product of randomness or an accident. It's built on the basis of very precise planning, very careful construction, and a great mind. Every gene carries certain orders for the production of certain amino acids and proteins, and certain enzymes, certain hormones, certain antibiotic products, and other than these of the necessary chemical compounds needed for the safety and construction of the human body. Of course, every one of these genes controls certain physical, psychological, and mental characters of the individual. Every living cell in the human body contains 46 of these chromosomes, of course, distributed between two pairs, 23 each. 22 pairs are concerned with the build-up of the body. They call it somatic cells. And of course, we have one pair responsible for reproduction. It is XX in the female and XY in the male. So we can see clearly that the shaping of a human embryo in the womb of the mother is a very complex process. No human being can have any control on it. The control is only to Allah, and any human intervention may destroy or distort this plan. A leading astronomer of our time wrote a book called The Intelligent Universe, and in this book he says, if we can unfold the genetic code of the human being, and each chromosome actually has got about 2 meters length. Okay, I'll stop here because we'll go for a short break, and then I'll continue this discussion after the break. And until then, I thank you for listening and wait for seeing you again.
Spread the word. Spread the word of Islam.
Welcome back after this short break. Before the break, I was mentioning a very leading astronomer of our time. His name is Fred Hoyle, Sir Fred Hoyle, who used to be a professor at Cambridge University. And this man lived all his life leading the atheistic trend in Britain, if not in the world. But when he retired, he had a ranch in northern Scotland, and he went there and he relaxed a little bit from the fight of publish or perish, and he wrote a wonderful book entitled The Intelligent Universe. And this book actually flows with signs of deep belief in Allah, in a great creator who has created this wonderful universe through will, knowledge, and wisdom. And one of the beautiful notions in the book is that Fred Hoyle says, if we can unfold the genetic code in the body of a single human being and arrange it one on top of the other, 100 million cells, each cell containing 46 chromosomes, each chromosome is about 2 meters length, and of course, if you put these on top of each other, it will exceed the distance between the Earth and the Sun, which is equal to 150 million kilometers. It will exceed this huge figure several times. And he would end by saying, this is very carefully arranged structure. Who placed it in my body? Can it be the product of a chance or an accident? It cannot. So he lived all his life an atheist and came to the age of reason to admit clearly that we are living in a very carefully built universe. Every single atom in it is actually very precisely calculated. And a sign of this is the structure of the human body. which is so complex, so beautifully arranged, that it can never ever be the product of an accident or a chance. Many biologists really wonder, how do the cells of each tissue, of each system, recognize each other and accumulate together to produce a certain tissue or a certain organ or a certain muscle or a certain bone? And this is a simple indication that creation, as demonstrated in the bodies of human beings, can never ever be the product of an accident or a chance, but it is the result of very, very careful planning that cannot be reached by any human being. We also see that the genes that are carried on these chromosomes are one of the wonders of the great creator. Other than the instructions they carry for the production of amino acids, of proteins, of enzymes, of hormones, of antibiotics, of other types of proteins which are highly needed for the different functions of the human body, we will find that every one of these genes also controls some of the characters, activities, and physical distinctive features for everybody that can easily distinguish him from others. Every living cell in the body of the human being carries 46 chromosomes, and the interaction between this very large number of genes, 20 to 25,000 genes from a father's side and 20 to 25,000 genes from the mother's side, the interaction between these two genes can give every single human being on Earth certain identifying features that cannot be repeated in another person. We'll find, of course, the fingerprints, the forehead prints, the genetic code, the voice print, the eye print, very many distinctive features. And this is really one of the marvels of creation that can easily testify to the greatness of the Creator, to the might, knowledge, and wisdom of the Creator, because no power on earth can achieve such a precision, particularly if we know that all human beings agree in the chemical composition of their DNA, 99%. The difference is only 1%. And out of this 1% difference in the chemical composition of the DNA, Allah has given every human being of the 7 billion that are living today, the billions that lived and died before us, and the billions who will come after us until the end of this life, every single human being has got a specific distinguishing characters that are not repeated in another human being. Again, if we imagine that every living cell is composed of protein molecules, and the protein molecules are composed of amino acids, and the amino acids are composed of five main components: carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, and sulfur. And it has been mathematically calculated that the accumulation of these five main elements that build an amino acid, to get these by randomness from 105 known elements on the surface of our planet, is virtually impossible. And this proves clearly that all the wrong allegations for the spontaneous development of life or spontaneous emergence of life is something, an escape goat to go away from admitting the glory of the Creator and submitting oneself to his obedience. Again, these five elements that constitute the amino acid are arranged in three dimensions, either in a right-hand direction or in a left-hand direction. They call it dextro and levo arrangements. In the bodies of all living beings, plants, animals, and humans, these five elements are arranged in a left-handed arrangement around the carbon atom. When the animal or the plant or the human die, they start rearranging themselves in the dextro arrangement, in the right-handed arrangement. And this is one of the most striking features to all scientists of our time. They call it the racemization of the amino acids. The being is dead, and he or it or she does not have any control anymore on its own body. What makes the amino acids, which were arranged sinistrally in the living body, would it change to the right-hand arrangement? This is one most striking features to all scientists of our time. This indicates that all these limitations can defy completely the randomness of development of life. Life cannot be produced by an accident or a chance. It needs a great creator who set the plan for every form of life and observes it and guards it and gives it its needed bounties. So we can see clearly in this verse, which Allah is inviting us to look into ourselves. The very first way of realizing who you are, who has created you and sent you into this world, what's your message in it, how you can fulfill that message to the best of your abilities, and what's for you after this life. And that's why the Quran reads, وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. And also, in your own selves, will you find enough evidence to testify to you that you are the product of a great creator. You could have never ever been brought by accident or a chance. And also, in your own selves, will you not then see? An invitation from Allah to meditate before anything else into the structure and the complexity of our own bodies. Because of this, we also read in the glorious Quran a verse that says a similar thing, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. Verily, we have created man in the best of shape. Because of this also, Allah, all glory be to him, advise us to look into other creations around ourselves. And inshallah, we'll continue with this topic in the coming few episodes. And until we meet, I thank you for listening. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, mercy, and blessings be with you all.
We are the Muslim Ummah, and each day that goes by, the harder we try, in gratitude we pray to Allah. Chosen as part of the best of mankind, we spread the word of Islam.